Cashflow Diary Podcast, episode 411.
Welcome to yet another exciting episode of the Cashflow Diary Podcast, the podcast that teaches you insider tips, tactics, and strategies for creating leveraged streams of cash flow into your life. Learn from top-performing entrepreneurs, business owners, investors, and thought leaders from across the globe as they share their secrets to success. Like what you learn on this and other Cashflow Diary podcast episodes? Go to learninvestingnow.com and sign up to receive powerful tips and information that will help you succeed as an entrepreneur and investor. Now, here's your host, investor, entrepreneur, business owner, educator, speaker, author, and master facilitator of Robert Kiyosaki's Cashflow Game, Jay Massey.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode of the Cashflow Diary Podcast. I'm your host, Jay Massey, and I'm glad that you're here today because when it comes down to building your business, making it grow, getting it started, making these things happen, what tends to happen is that you want to make really excellent decisions. You got to learn how to do that. And I know for myself personally, one of the things that we often rely on is, well, just data. You know, and there's a lot of data out there today, and you can get your data from so many different places, but making the wrong decision or interpreting the data incorrectly or relying on a faulty premise regarding your data or just how it's collected, there's so many things that comes to the idea of data that can still lead you down a wrong path. Because whether you realize it or not, we're still human, and there's a human factor inside of all of this that can make business really, really challenging. So I have with me today someone who's going to help us with exactly figuring out some of our toughest business problems, if you will, when it comes to data. But most importantly, he's written a book that I think you're going to want to read because have you ever wondered, how does Facebook make its decisions, or how does these algorithms work in order to help you and I, you know, be at the top of search engines and figure out these things and why it's important? I think we're going to get some insight into understanding that because I have with me today none other than Christian Madsbjerg. He's the founder of Red Associates and the director of its New York office and author of a couple of books. One you may have heard of, The Moment of Clarity, Using Human Sciences to Solve Your Toughest Business Problems. And the new book is Sensemaking, which is definitely causing a disturbance because we're talking about the power of humanities in the age of the algorithm. Now, if you are ready to have your mind expanded, that's exactly what's going to happen. And inside that expanse is going to be answers that you've been looking for. So help me welcome Christian Madsbjerg. Christian, how are you doing?
I'm good. Thank you for inviting me.
I'm glad that you're here. Thanks for making the time. Now, before we get started, I have to ask you a question that I tend to ask everybody the first time that they're here. Are you ready?
Right.
Okay. I tend to look at today's entrepreneurs a lot like yesterday's superheroes. So if you think about it, entrepreneurs and superheroes have a ton of things in common. Occasionally, we can envision ourselves using our knowledge, products, and services, saving customers, etc. And just like a superhero, an entrepreneur has a beginning. If you think about Spider-Man, for example, there was a time where he, Peter Parker, was just a student going around taking photos, etc. And then one day, something happens to him. He gets bit by a spider, and now he's got this new information. He's got this new thing he's operating with, and he gets to choose to whether to use it for good and or evil. And obviously, in his case, he chooses good. So my question to you is follows. Before your books, before being featured in places like the Wall Street Journal, The Atlantic, The Economist, Fortune, Forbes, and many other leading publications, before all the things that people know you for today, what we want to know is, who is Christian Madsbjerg?
Right, that's a big question. I thought I would be an academic, and I always thought that because I like books and I like thinking about things. But then I learned what the university was like, and I found it extraordinarily drab and boring. I found it slow and political, and they were fighting over things that I found just I didn't understand why they were fighting over it.
Right.
So instead of that, instead of becoming a professor, I founded a company. And when I started spending time with companies, both big and small, I just didn't understand how they were making their decisions and what they were making their decisions on. And it blew my mind that people could make that many mistakes when there were available information about markets and customers and so on. And that was really the beginning of the consultancy I founded when I was 22. And I'm on my fourth consultancy, basically the same consultancy, just different versions of it.
Interesting. I like it. There's an iterative nature to your business for sure. But something you said that I think many of us can resonate with is understanding the slow and political nature of other things. But most importantly, you said you didn't understand how people were making their decisions or making so many mistakes. Can you expound upon that for a little minute?
Right. I saw a couple of stats. I remember when I was in my early 20s, the first one was that out of all decisions made above $1 billion mm-hmm. in corporations around the world, 10% of those are made on data.
Whoa.
Right. That means that 9 out of 10 decisions are taken just from the gut. And it better be a good gut then.
Wow.
So that was disturbing. And the second one was that 92% of product launches fail. So that means that out of 100 new products, 92 of them die within a year.
Wow.
So that's a lot, right? And if you think about all the things that companies are making, and you look at it, you think, like, who did this? I mean, what was the process behind this? And it turned out that you could actually be helpful, or at least it turned out for me that I could be helpful in thinking straight about markets and consumers and inform these decisions in a way. And we haven't gotten to 100% on any of the two, but I think we certainly have improved some of the areas. So that was really the beginning, was just wondering why are they doing this? And I sort of felt maybe I could help. And quite quickly, I got to work for the big German company Adidas. Mm. And started making shoes and running equipment and soccer equipment and so on. And then Intel called, and then I started working with Lego, and you know, and so on. So it wasn't really a strategy that much as a sort of a core idea about how to work and how to be organized about thinking about markets and customers. And I think that's not just happening in big corporations. Small corporations need that too. I think in the entrepreneurs you're talking about, the Spider-Mans of the future are the ones that get that right.
Yeah, but I'm sorry, I'm still stuck on 92% of product launches fail. That seems abnormally high. It almost makes me wonder, like, how does anything ever get in the store or make it to the market? Or, man, I mean, that's, you know, talking to someone who, like, if someone's listening right now who's, like, thinking, ooh, I got a great idea, you just, I mean, that one stat alone is enough to make them go, well, maybe my idea isn't so great.
Right. But if you think about your car, I would guess that you would use maximum a third of the features in that car.
Sure.
And those features are very expensive to develop. And the way they're communicated to you is through that book in your glove compartment that nobody ever, ever reads or even opens, right?
That's true. You know where it is.
So you have all this technology that is poorly communicated and that doesn't fit into your life really. And so that starts making sense, right? And then if you go down the aisle of any supermarket, especially the center aisles of any supermarket, and see the versions that they make of this and that and the other, you can start understanding that most of this isn't really that helpful.
So in essence, what you're saying is that entrepreneurs in general are guessing.
Yeah. I say that they look at their own world. So if you live in Silicon Valley, your own world looks in a particular way. Mm. And then you think you can make something for people that live in a very different way. They might live in Western China or in Brazil or in the South in America. And their world is quite different. often. And the good thing, the good news is that there's data on that. But quite often people just guess based on their own experience and their own world. And that can be disastrous, and can especially be disastrous if you're in a big corporation. So the CEOs and the boards I work with, I mean, the CEOs in the auto industry haven't bought a car for 30 years. Mm. They lead very different lives in corporate offices where people take care of the lunch and fill up the gas tank. And they're very different from the customers that actually buy the products. So the more abstract it becomes, the more distant we become from the customers that we should have a fundamental sensitivity to, or an ability to understand. And I think the ones that are good at that are some entrepreneurs. Some entrepreneurs just get what a group of people would really like or would really appreciate. And they are the ones that will be successful. And I think all great entrepreneurs and all great companies are founded on an insight. It's founded on an insight into a group of people and how to serve them in a meaningful way.
Interesting. So let me ask this question then. When it comes to serving, like you said, a group of people in a meaningful way, that let's pretend I don't have that insight, but I think I want to serve this group of people with a product or a service or whatever I'm thinking of. How do I, is there a scientific, data-driven way for me to get some of that insight to make sure that I do that?
Yes, there are many methods, and they're all sort of developed from the social sciences.
Okay.
So that would be places like sociology and anthropology and so on.
You realize that those were all classes we fell asleep in, right?
I know. And, you know, maybe then you should get somebody else to help you, because many of them need jobs. So, you know, so I think you can hire them.
I like it.
Sociology is basically understanding culture, and anthropology is understanding groups of people. And you can extract information from them in many ways. You can ask them things in surveys or in focus groups. And there's so much of that data out there already. Asking people is an industry, like the service, the sort of the focus group industry and the survey industry is around $30 billion a year.
Wow.
We ask people a lot about things. You can also go and spend time with them, which is what anthropologists would do, and sort of look at their life and look at what it seems like they need. And I think the core of this is that very few people really have an ability to express or to talk about what they want and need, especially for the future, and especially if the product category is new. So if you have something really innovative on your mind, looking at people and listening to them is better than asking them. And that would be sort of the more anthropological side. And then, of course, there's a new sort of development in the past, I guess, 5 to 10 years, is that we can now track a lot of behavior digitally. So we can track people's phones, and we can make patterns in their Instagram feeds and in their Facebook feeds and so on, and sort of combine that with sales data. And that's a sort of a very technical thing where you need statisticians and computer science people and so on. And that becomes quickly quite expensive if you're not a Fortune 500 company. That's called computational sociology, and is sort of a big trend that I'm excited about.
Got it. So let's pretend for a moment that I want to play in this world, and I want it, obviously, if I've got a product, if I got a service, I want it to succeed. What's a smaller guy to do who might not have the budget for something like that? Is there some sort of, can we get close? What can we do to reasonably approximate get the same information without having to hire what it sounds like some very expensive, smart people?
Right. And so our service is targeted at the top 300 companies in the world, or in America, maybe 50 to 100 companies. And that makes no sense for a startup. Yet there are many of the things we do that a startup could easily do as well.
Okay.
And I think should do. And one of them is buying a plane ticket to the place that is most different from your own world, yet is a place where you want to sell your things.
So, okay, hold on. What do you mean? Give me, I mean, can you give me a more concrete example? Because one, right. I like the idea of going somewhere. That sounds great, but I'm trying to understand it a little bit better.
So let's say you want to sell soft drinks
okay.
to the Chinese
okay.
Or to the people in Brazil. Going there is a good idea to see how soft drinks are consumed, with what they are consumed, how they buy them, how they choose between different ones, how it feels, how it relates to food, and so on. So basically just spending time with some of the customers that you want to engage is a good start. And we do this also for humorous reasons too. I mean, we take out people from some of the biggest companies in America, and these are people that live, you know, they have drivers and they have chief of staffs and all of those kinds of things. And we take them out and spend a couple of days with just a normal consumer. So if they are in healthcare, we take them to hospitals and to people's homes and so on. And it blows their mind that people choose things the way they choose it and do the things that they do. And that's not something you have to have a lot of money to do. It just go to people's home and see who their friends are and see how they work and so on. And just listening to that with a lot of attention and stop talking for a second, I think is quite helpful. And we see, you know, I've had the CEO of a major auto company come out and spend time with the people that buy his smallest cars. And he was just like, they are on a budget. He was like quite surprised that these people are on a budget when they buy a car. And it's like, yeah, of course they are. They don't lead the life you do. And he would also find that their cars are a mess because there's not a people that cleans his, you know, like him, that cleans his car every day and so on. Or I've had people from, a big beverage company in the South go to China actually for 2 days, just seeing how people dealt with tea and what they drank and where they drank it and so on. And the entire portfolio changed because of that. Also the way you market to people, the language they use about it and so on. So going to the savannah instead of the Sioux, going to the actual area where people lead their lives and listen for a change and observe is an extremely good way to get started on any endeavor. And I think many, many great entrepreneurs will do this naturally.
Interesting. So one of the things that I've often shared with people is that when trying to figure out, you know, the customer that you want to serve, I've often suggested start with a person who's most like yourself, because that one would be easier to understand. What would you say?
I think that is certainly the case, that if you have an intuition with the customer group, that's a big upside. So the people that make trucks in Detroit, they are like them. They understand the people that buy trucks. But so they have an intuition with them, and that's why they're quite successful. But they're not so successful making normal cars to people because they don't care about normal cars. So I think if you choose somebody that you feel you understand, that's a good start. And if you don't understand them, then there are ways to deal with that, which is engage in their life, try to listen, try to understand what their world is like. And especially if it's in the medical field, if you want to sell something to people with cancer or with diabetes, then maybe you need to understand what it's like to be that them and to walk in their shoes for a little bit.
Okay. So here's something that I'm thinking about, because when you bring up medical, I mean, obviously that's a very large and growing field in many different ways. But I know we have a number of people who are looking to serve the medical community in various forms, specifically through housing and whatnot, say, you know, assisted living or elder care or even short-term rental housing for extended medical procedures. When considering housing, like how would this process change, you know, what you're talking about, what we're providing isn't necessarily a product or soda that we're shipping to them, but a place where we're expecting to house or for them to reside for a period of time. Hello there, entrepreneur. This is Jay Massey. I know that if you've ever gone over to the site cashflowdiary.com, you may have asked yourself, where on earth do you get a domain name from? Especially as you are beginning to build your bigger, better, badder business, You need a web presence. You need the email address. You need a way for people to contact you electronically so that you can stop doing the at gmail.com game. Well, the good folks over at GoDaddy have definitely supplied us with every domain that we have ever used. So what I want you to do is I want you to go over to trygodaddy.com/cashflowdiary. Again, that's trygodaddy.com/cashflowdiary, because it's a quick way for you to get set up to capture your domain name the exact way that you want it. They got easy search functions, and most importantly for you is that you'll be up and running today. As I said, once you get started, stay started. Don't let small little obstacles of how to get your own domain name going stop you. So again, go to trygodaddy.com/cashflowdiary and let's get back to the rest of the story.
It's the same thing. You would have to go maybe a little longer there, but it's still about how do they get around? How do they relate to their kids? How do they cook? Those kinds of things are all aspects of how to make a housing service or sell housing to them, or technology or whatever you want to sell. You have to go and see how they live. Because if I'm 42 years old and I don't know what it's like to be 72 and moving into assisted care housing,
right?
I can guess, but I don't have very good data and I don't have a very good intuition about what that is like. So instead of guessing and become one of those 92% of mistakes, I would rather go and spend a couple of days with these people or a week with these people and try to understand what it's like, and then develop hypotheses about what can we do to improve this. And then you can always test those hypotheses in other data sets. But it's the ability to try to understand them truly as people. That's the core here.
And you're saying you could, I mean, a week sounds incredibly short to be able to do what you're talking about to me.
Right. We do multi-year monster projects. But if you are a startup and you have limited budget,
right,
a week is better than no week.
Good point.
So you got to start somewhere. And you would also, it'll blow people's mind if they go and spend some time with people that live a very different life than their own, how much you can learn just because you are a human, just because you want to understand their life and truly want to listen to their stories and their, look at their practices, that you can learn a lot in a week.
So let me ask you this. Let's pretend that the entrepreneurs listening and those in the marketplace say, okay, I believe you, Christian. I'm going to do this because I don't want to be a part of that 92%. Do you have some sort of measurement or way to figure how to decrease that number so that more people end up in a successful position?
I think there are many ways to do this. And I think also a lot of the failure rate comes from bad launches and poor logistics and all kinds of sort of more practical things. But I'd say that from a product conceptualization standpoint, or whether that is housing or technology or something you ship to people, I think there are two things that's important. The first one is insight, that you truly feel you understand who you're talking to and why you should be relevant to them. So why are you relevant? Right now, there's a lot of things out there. So why this now? And then I think the second thing is that you innovate on many different things at the same time. That is not just maybe the product. It's also the way you sell it, or the way they own it, or the way you service it, or the way it's delivered to them. That the innovation that is happening in a startup is not just on a better technology. That's great, but it's even better if that technology is wrapped in a new way, or sold in a way, or marketed in a way that's different. So I would think about this insight about these people. How do we change the entire value chain? How do we look at every single aspect and not be conservative on any of those points, and see the places that we can reinvent, we will do it, and the places where we can't, we won't. But several things at the same time often is where the really successful products happen.
Got it. It's not just the fact it's the same idea, but you're saying it's a repackaging of the same idea, maybe even taking that same idea but describing it differently in a way that's more relatable to the person that you're actually trying to target, even though fundamentally it could be, like you said, housing.
Exactly. The same product can seem very, very different if you change a few other things, like the way you package it, the way you sell it, the way you own it, and so on. So all innovation is not necessarily technology. It can be marketing. It can be many other things. And I think being open to that and take the insight that you have and the way you understand the customer group and drive it into all those aspects rather than just into technology, which is the obvious one for most startups.
Yeah. Okay. Got it. All right. So let's talk about this book, Sensemaking. The subtitle is The Power of the Humanities in the Age of the Algorithm. Help me understand, how did you evolve to seeing the need to actually publish and write this book?
Right. So in the corporations I work in and in the sort of my daily life, I spend time primarily with the Fortune 50 companies of the world. And they are so distant from human life that you can't even imagine it. They fly corporate jets, they, you know, all that.
Right.
And I think that we, and then they rely on data that is rather thin. So it's often like 73% thinks this or 24% of the customer group thinks that, which means that these people that they're talking to become abstractions. They become sort of abstract groups and numbers. And I think that's too far away from the customer group to really come up with something interesting and helpful and to make judgment calls on what's good and what's bad in terms of the pipeline of products or the marketing of them or whatever it is. So I'm concerned that we lose our innate ability to understand each other if we have so much data that is thin. I call it thin data. So data that's abstractions between us and the world. And I basically say that the most successful people in America right now all have a background in understanding culture. So if you look across the board of the big CEOs in the banks and so on, they studied history and French and all kinds of things. And they use that to understand the data. And I think that's crucial, because if you don't have that aspect of being interested in people, truly and honestly interested in culture and people, then you will have a hard time selling things, particularly to countries that are different than your own. So that's basically what the book is about. It's that there are tool sets that come from the humanities, and that includes the kind of things I talked about before about going to people's home and so on, that are necessary to be successful and competitive in the future. And I found that people rely on data, thin data, as a clutch rather than really challenging it. And I'm concerned about that because it leads to all kinds of mistakes and misunderstandings and bad product, basically.
Yeah, no, well, I'm thinking about this in the context of the hospitality industry, right? Because those who would be, again, housing people from a completely different country, there are just so many things that you would need to know about that type of that group, or, you know, when people are coming to stay with you or serving them in various different forms. What if you have a service that's so international, if you will? How on earth are you to be able to make sense of these things so that you can actually make it work when you're customer profile can be so diverse?
Right. Well, that is hard. And it's in the hospital, if you think about hotels or restaurants and so on, I think the good idea here is to not look at these people when they come as numbers, not look at them as 13% of our customers come from South America.
Mm-hmm.
And then just look at them as a sort of a data set, but rather look at them as people and wanting to understand and pick up on their cues that I'm sure they're sending you on how they would like things. And I think that's quite endearing as well, if people truly try to understand you and what it is you wanna do. And I think the best hotels that I've been to and the best restaurants I've been to, they have that sort of hospitality sensitivity that is all about wanting to understand how to serve. So I think the problem is when we end up treating them just like a segment or a customer journey or a, you know, some sort of abstract model.
Mm. Well, okay, so let me ask this then. What if that task is just too, it's just too large? What about choosing one or two of those customer segments and to the exclusion of the others simply because, you know, I've got limited resources, limited time, limited everything, and we just double down on the ones that we think we can serve the best? Where would you fall on that spectrum?
Absolutely. I mean, it depends on how you want to compete. But if you feel that there are a couple of customer groups that you want to attract and then market to them, mm-hmm. then the rest can come if they want to, but only if they do, right? So I think that's probably not an unreasonable thing to do. Yet there are hotels where you don't know who's coming, right?
Right.
And all you can do is you can try to market to a certain group, but you can end up with a lot of misunderstanding, and that happens every day. I mean, there are movies about how if you go to Japan, I mean, you don't understand what on earth is going on, right? And that's not necessarily a bad experience; it's just weird. But I think as an entrepreneur, choosing your target group and understanding it should be at the heart of the strategy.
Well, I'm trying to think of a business where this isn't going to apply because. Specifically the diversification, because so many businesses are online today, your customer can, quote unquote, kind of come from anywhere. I can't imagine that there's any business that doesn't need some sort of department or research or information on this topic in some way, shape, or form. So what else are we going to find in the book that's going to help us do this, man?
Right. I mean, there's also, I mean, if you take the aspect of employees, if the best engineers in the world say, right. and you want to, then they are from India and China and they're from everywhere,
right?
Germany probably, and you have to deal with them and understand them. So there again, you need that sort of sensitivity to other people as part of the leadership team,
right.
not just as an outsourced department, but as an ingrained sort of component of running a company. And the bigger the company becomes and the more successful it becomes, the more it's necessary. In the book, I write sort of five principles mm-hmm. for understanding people. And that is one of them I've talked about, which is going to the savannah instead of going to the zoo. So going to the place where people really live rather than guessing about it or going to some sort of abstract version about it.
Right.
But there's a set of other things in terms of what I call thick data. So thick data is the description of people's experience. So how do you experience being old? How do you experience owning a car? How do you experience, you know, going to a restaurant? Trying to understand what that experience is like. We call thick description. And thick description is something that you can't really extract other than observe and listen. And there are techniques in there in the book of how to do that. So it's not, I think the good news here is that we all do it every day. We all try to understand other people. We all try to live with our spouses or kids or their friends and our colleagues. This is just being rigorous, systematic, and organized about it, and try to make it into sort of a discipline where understanding other people becomes something you're aware of and work with all the time rather than something you wing whenever it's necessary.
Well, what's really happening for me as I listen to you is that it's realigning the priorities in which this is dealt with. I think for a lot of entrepreneurs, myself included, we can take this idea and go, yeah, that'll be nice. We'll get there later. We'll do that later. Right now, let's go sell some stuff. Right. And what you're actually saying is if you want to have better, if you wanted to not be in that 92% category, you should probably consider this on the front end as opposed to like an optimization or something that's optional. That's what I'm hearing.
Absolutely. So I would think your podcast is based on an understanding of the listener. The listener will be of a particular kind, and you would understand where that listener is at, because actually you're one of them.
Right.
And I think that core insight is what drives who you want to talk to, what you want to talk about, what you want to ask. And so you're already doing it. What I'm saying is that putting emphasis on it. And sometimes you got to go sell some stuff, and I completely get that. But it's easier to sell it if the people that you're selling it to wants it and you know how to talk to them about it. And I think if you spend some time with some of your listeners who I'm sure are fascinating individuals, it would be impossible for you not to get hundreds of ideas for episodes just based on looking at what they struggle with and where they're at in their career and in their sort of building of a new company.
Indeed. Indeed, 100%. Here's what I know right now. I know that there's a number of people who are clamoring for more information because suddenly we have an interest in anthropology like we've never had before. And we want to know how to use it and leverage it to help us, you know, build our bigger, better, badder business. What's going to be a great way for them to track you down, find out more about what you're doing over at Red and how they can obtain more information, maybe even a copy of the book?
Right. So the book is on Amazon and in all bookstores. It should be at least. My company Red Associates has a website that's redassociates.com, where we have a ton of videos and sort of little films and articles about this way of working that I hope they're meant to be helpful for anyone. Where we show how we look at health and financial areas and how we make phones and TVs and so on, and how we've sort of been working with these techniques and how the best companies in the world are working with these techniques to create the future, really. So those are ready. Those can be sort of found on the website, redassociates.com.
Awesome. So as we wind down here, I have a final question for you because I'm curious to hear what your answer is going to be. Let's pretend for a moment that someone listening they're at the beginning of their journey. You know, they think they want to jump into this pool. They don't want to be in that 92%. They want to get better results. But, you know, maybe they're even standing in front of what I would call the superhero outfit store. They're going to try this entrepreneurship thing and they're going to put on their cape and tights and go make that happen. However, as often happens when we make these types of decisions, they have a companion with them, and that companion comes in the form of a voice, and it's in the back of their head, reminds them what they can't do, how it won't work, who they're not, all this other stuff that tends to go on. And for some people, they're even related to that voice. So my question to you is as follows. Let's pretend that this person is actually going to follow through, Christian. They're going to do what you suggest, and they're going to do so in the next 24 to 48 hours. What would you suggest that they do?
I would suggest that they go and get strength from understanding the people that they want to serve. When you look at people's life, let's take your example of the assisted home mm-hmm. situation. Mm-hmm. You would be so inspired by all the things you could do for them that would give you even more interest and even more energy to go and do create a great business out of it. I think the most inspiring thing for people is looking at the need they can solve and looking at how much it would help people if they did so. So I think it's only inspiring to go and meet the customers that you serve, and it would probably shut down that voice that you're talking about because you know, at that point you know you can be helpful. And that's the start of any great business.
Awesome and well said. I definitely appreciate the work that you're doing because if someone would tell me that the answers to my business problems lie in sociology or anthropology or something like that, I would look at them a little funny. But the fact that you've done this work and you're applying it in such a very useful way, it's something that I know that we're all benefiting from, and whether we realize it or not. And more importantly, it's something that we can do, which is great. And I definitely thank you for taking the time to invest here with us your knowledge, your wisdom, as well as your insights, sir, today at the Cashflow Diary.
Well, thank you. Your listeners are the future, so there's nothing more exciting to talk to, is there? I mean, it's a great group.
Awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, you know what time it is. It's time for you to move at the speed of instruction. What does that mean? That means today, get over to redassociates.com, pick up a copy of Sensemaking. More importantly, read it. Do it. You're like, what? I had no idea these things would make a difference in my business. Yes, I know. The idea of hanging out with the customer group that you wish to serve, I can tell you, was not necessarily at the top of my mind. It is now. Who knows? For some of you, that could imply that you get to go travel somewhere. So go have some fun. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been fun talking to you today. I look forward to talking to you soon. Until next time.